Well, good afternoon, everyone. I'm pleased to be able to join you here. I'm joined, of course, by the Treasurer, General Frewin and Professor Kelly. I'm also joined by Professor Jodie McKernan, thank you, Jodie, it's good to see you. We've been seeing a lot of the Doherty Institute of late, and I'll be asking Professor McKernan to speak to you through the video conference this morning, and we are releasing today the Doherty report that was provided both to the National Cabinet and, of course, the Federal Cabinet in releasing the National Plan and the vaccination targets that I announced on Friday evening from the Lodge. Can I just make a couple of opening remarks before I throw to Professor McKernan? She will be followed by the Treasurer, who will be outlining the advice that we have received through the Treasury process that is aligned with the work that has been done with the Doherty Institute. And both General Frewin and Professor Kelly are available to deal with any questions that arise, as well as Professor McKernan. We all know that the world is in a serious battle with the Delta strain of COVID-19. This has been a long war against this virus, and there have been many, many battles. And this is a fierce one when it comes to the Delta strain. As I've said on many occasions, Australia is not alone in this battle. This battle has been fought right across the world as every single country is adapting and changing its responses to ensure that they can get on top of this. Just last night, I was talking to the Greek Prime Minister about these very issues, and I'm in regular contact with many leaders around the world talking about how they are responding to and dealing with this most recent strain. So Australia also is joined in this battle. The tools that have helped us so much over the course of the last 18 months and more have indeed been blunted by the Delta strain. That is a clear learning, and that means we have had to adjust our response. And so the reactions of short, hopefully, but strong lockdowns to ensure that the Delta strain does not get away from us, as we're seeing now in southeast Queensland, as we saw indeed in Victoria and South Australia, and regrettably in New South Wales, where the lockdown continues. This is now our first response when it comes to dealing with the Delta strain. When the circumstances change, you must change with them. Under the earlier strains of this virus, then those tools did enable us to be able to prevent lockdowns. It did enable us to manage when cases presented. That has all changed with the Delta strain. The Delta strain is the game changer, and our response has had to change with those changing circumstances. All throughout this year, though, whether it was Delta or Alpha, we've been working to chart the way back to living with the virus. Of course, the virus will never be eliminated. It can take a very, very long time for any infectious disease that is resident in any population around the world, as I'm sure Professor Kelly will tell you, and indeed Professor McKernan, to eliminate viruses around the world. But you can get to a point where you live with them. And we have been charting out that course since the beginning of this year, indeed, when I first tasked Secretary Gaitchens to work with his counterparts in the states and territories. That process led to the first piece of work that was done by the Doherty Institute that was based on the Alpha strain. And at the end of June, it was very clear that we would have to go back and do it again because of the Delta strain that had now become very clear. And that advice was presented to National Cabinet. So last Friday, I announced Australia's plan to live with the virus. I announced the whole country's plan to get us back to that position where we can ultimately live with this virus in the same way that we live with other infectious diseases that are present in the community, and we can get on with our lives. That plan is based on common sense precautions that prevail, and it is based on a pathway on vaccination that provides the protection necessary to ensure the many tools we have to suppress the virus and its impact on lives and livelihoods are held at bay. The targets that are part of this plan, the vaccination targets of 70% to get to the next phase and 80% to phase C, are based on the world's best scientific analysis and economic advice. Australia has been well served over these more than 18 months, as we have charted our own Australian way through this pandemic. An Australian way with Australian results that are different to almost every other country in the world, bar a few. An Australian way that has delivered Australian results that has saved more than 30,000 lives. 30,000 Australians and more would be dead today were it not for the COVID response that Australia has put in place. And I say all of Australia because everyone has played their part in achieving that outcome. If we had the same incidence of fatality, of serious disease experienced by advanced countries of the world, just like Australia's, with serious health systems that can respond to these sorts of pandemics, if we'd had their results, more than 30,000 Australians would be dead today. But it's not just that, as the Treasurer will remind you, because Australia is also off the COVID-19 recession last year, got 1 million Australians back at work. Now that is under challenge again because of the restrictions we have regrettably but necessarily had to put in place. But Australia's economic performance and our health performance, saving lives and saving livelihoods, are amongst the world's best and are the product of, in this country, always finding our Australian way through this pandemic to get the Australian results that have protected lives and livelihoods. The vaccination program, we have overcome those early challenges, which are very familiar to everyone around the country. And I particularly want to thank General Frewen, who joins me here today, who at the beginning of June took on my task to head up the whole of government effort. I want to thank all those working in the health department and around the country, the GPs, the pharmacists, those working in the state hubs, who are getting these vaccines out every single day, to the point now we have some 12.5 million vaccines that have been delivered or thereabouts. The fact that we now have 1 in 5 Australians who have received double dose. We now have 2 in 5 Australians who've had a first dose. We have around 2/3 of Australians aged over 50 who've had a first dose. We have almost 80% of Australians aged over 70 who've had a first dose. And of course, in our aged care facilities, more than 80% of those residents have had double doses. So it can be done. It will be done. I have great faith in the Australian people to get this done. Tremendous faith in their determination and their motivation to get this job done. Because I've seen it each and every day as we've led together Australia through this crisis. I've seen their courage. I've seen their selflessness. I've seen their determination. I've seen their sacrifice. And that is what has got Australia through to where we are today. I have great faith in the Australian people to get this country vaccinated. We are making our own Australian way through it. And today, I want to share the expert scientific advice through our experts who are here with us today that have informed this decision about the 70 and 80% targets to get us to the next phase of the national plan to get Australia in a position where we are living with the virus. So I'll hand over to Professor McVernon, to you, Jodie, and then I'll go to the Treasurer to speak to the economic analysis and advice that has come in parallel with that advice and work together, and then happy to take questions. Jodie.
Thank you, Prime Minister. And there's a presentation that I believe will be on screen concurrently, which I have a copy of here.
Might just have the volume up a bit in the room, if we could, please. Okay, please proceed, Professor.
Fine, thank you very much. All right, so this slide set summarises the work. Next slide, please. And some top line findings here really are the purpose of the work, which was to identify vaccine thresholds that could enable the transitions to phase B and C of the national plan. There's a strong emphasis on maintaining high vaccination rates across phases by offering all adults a vaccine earlier. And in phase B and C, we are recommending, based on the evidence, that ongoing low-level or baseline restrictions and effective test, trace, isolate, quarantine, what I'll refer to as TTIQ responses, should be used to minimise cases in the community and keep case numbers low. And as the Prime Minister's mentioned, the experience with Delta has shown that under Phase A, at the present time, lockdowns should be optimally early, stringent and short. Next slide, please. The next slide details the national plan phases, which the Prime Minister has already announced and described on Friday. I won't go into detail on that today, but we'll move on to the evidence underpinning those determinations. Next slide, please. Overall, our modelling makes a series of recommendations, and the key recommendations are covered here, and I'll unpack the evidence behind them in the subsequent slides. So I think the first thing to make very clear is we've heard a lot of discussion of herd immunity thresholds and some magic number where there's a binary cutoff, and above that, life is normal, and below that, we haven't achieved our goal. Vaccination coverage is a continuum. Every Australian who is immunised helps to protect themselves, their families and their community, and that will help to reduce transmission and negative health outcomes. And we look at the outcomes of vaccination to reduce transmission in potential at this point in the population strategy as a way of reducing those adverse outcomes. We bring to this the understanding based on evidence here and internationally that young adults are peak transmitters of COVID-19, our elder populations and special risk groups are those at highest burden of severe health impacts, and our program to date has focused on reducing those impacts by directly protecting those groups. What we're proposing now is a shift in strategy at this phase of the program, having got to where we have, and the Prime Minister's outlined those figures, in order to really maximise the benefits of this program across all individuals in the population. And as said in the summary points, vaccination alone is a very big part of the answer, but it is not the whole answer. We must maintain ongoing public health and social measures. Next slide, please. So we were asked to explore a series of vaccine coverage thresholds between 50 and 80%. And our simulations basically looked at, should an outbreak become uncontrolled in those conditions, what would the consequences be? And based on that, to provide advice about safe thresholds and strategies for moving to the next phase. At 50 and 60%, we anticipate rapidly growing outbreaks that would be very difficult to control and would require stringent social measures. As we reach 70 and 80%, the need for long, stringent measures across whole of states or across extended areas, we believe, will be substantively reduced. And the graphic on the top right of this slide basically makes that point for what we consider to be the optimal scenario, showing that for different levels of coverage, we're able to reduce transmission through vaccination to the extent that the need for prolonged lockdowns to regain control should be substantially diminished. Next slide, please. This slide's a critical conceptual slide that really brings together all of the key messages of our work in a single graphic. So the Prime Minister's referred to the fact that this Delta variant has been a game changer internationally. And that's because it has a much higher reproduction number. The number of secondary cases that each infected person is likely to make is essentially double that of the original SARS-CoV-2 strains we were looking at in early 2020. And we, in the absence of having circulating cases most of the time in our population because of effective controls, have developed a metric called transmission potential, which basically summarises the characteristics of the population at any point in time that would enable the spread of virus. And this work's been conducted by a team around the country, as has all of this work, and the group doing the modelling presented today has strong complementarity and overlap with the group who deliver weekly situational assessment reports to the Australian Health Protection Principle Committee. And based on review of what has happened in Australia, based on how they have seen the population behave, how we see mobility patterns in response to different restrictions, and how those levels of restriction have been able to constrain the virus in Australia, we have put together a series of bundles and descriptions of those activities that have been able to be shared with Treasury and provide this advice. So starting from a very high R0 or transmission potential I'm going to talk about now for Delta, we can see that the kind of baseline public health and social measures of hand hygiene and keeping your distance and where applicable wearing masks are actually able to put some constraint on the virus. And when we have a highly effective TTIQ capacity, the public health response, those two together are very useful to already reduce the transmission potential of this virus. And you can see that That brings that those pink salmon bars, you may not be able to see well, but come down to another dotted line, which is basically the Wuhan strain transmission potential. So just those measures get us back to where we started from. We then overlay vaccine coverage at different levels, and these are the blue bars, and 50, 60, 70, 80 have increasing effectiveness, as you would imagine, to reduce transmission, and that will bring the transmission potential down further. However, you can see that to actually control outbreaks altogether, we need to reach the dotted line that crosses one, at which epidemics do not grow. And you can see that at 50 or 60% coverage, we're still a long way from that line. The green bars in different degrees of shading show the ability of overlaid social restrictions to reduce transmission potential further. And you can see that at 50 or 60%, it would be highly likely that stringent or moderate social restrictions, and our stringent restrictions here are Victoria's phase four lockdown back in wave two in 2020, would be needed to keep control or regain control of the situation. At 70%, we're at a position where the light, low public health and social measures are able to keep us grazing that bar of one, and combined with an effective and well-preserved public health response, could help to turn what might otherwise be a bushfire into more of a controlled backburn and keep case numbers low. And at 80% coverage, we would be more confident that some greater social freedoms might be allowed with that level of immunisation. Next slide, please. Just to unpack why this is important, and these slides are not projecting well on the screen, I can see, so I'm going to have to talk through the figures. But as we move to higher levels of coverage, the rates of symptomatic and severe infections are greatly reduced in situations where vaccination is holding the line and we don't have those overlaid social measures. So this is still a suboptimal strategy, but it's showing you why those overlaid measures are important. As we move, if on the top left graphic, up from 50% at the bottom to 80% coverage, we can see that the number of symptomatic infections reduces, as do the severe infections arising from it. The graphic that I suspect you can't see on the bottom right breaks those severe infections down into deaths, ICU admissions and ward admissions, and obviously they're all decreased across the board. Now, this is an artificial scenario that we've modelled. We're assuming some models are wrong or some models are useful, but we are making a strategic case here by looking at the whole population and saying if we can achieve this coverage evenly, this is what we can do. Obviously, in implementation, it will be very important to ensure that jurisdictions, small areas, key subpopulations achieve these high coverage thresholds, because while unvaccinated groups remain, there is still potential for transmission and outbreaks and severe disease outcomes in groups who are not reached by immunisation. The next slide speaks...
Just we might just hold that there, because that slide people weren't able to see. But just to reinforce a point that you've made to us on several occasions, that when you get it down to 80%, the sort of death, hospitalisation and infection rates is what you expect to see with something like the flu.
Thanks, Prime Minister. All right, so we're now on slide 7 of the pack. Thank you. This slide speaks to the strategic shift. So we started with our population immunisation coverage, working with the team in health who have been supporting Australia's vaccine rollout, so with up-to-date information on supply, distribution, capacity, to devise a series of scenarios about how we might use our vaccine from here. So we started at a census date of 12th July, having already achieved high coverage in many of the at-risk groups, and explored strategies for next allocations. And there are two strategies that are compared on this slide. If you look at the figure on the bottom left, we refer to two different allocation strategies, one called oldest first, which basically means we keep working our way down the age groups in the population and try to maximise uptake before moving to the next. Another hypothetical strategy we called all adults. As a comparison, we said, what happens if we just offer vaccine to everybody right now? How will that serve the program? And you can see that at each achieved threshold vaccination coverage, the all adults blue line is well below the oldest first brown line, showing that there's obviously the way you allocate that strategy and who is covered in the population is important. And I'll try to cover off on the figure on the right briefly. This is called an age-based transmission matrix, or a who acquires infection from whom matrix. This is a standard tool in infectious disease modelling. And it acknowledges the fact that people who are in the population of different ages mix differently with others and may be more or less susceptible and infectious than others. So these charts start with social surveys that ask people who they come into contact with. Not surprisingly, we find that most people hang out with people about their age. So if we look at where the matrix squares are darkest, there's always a strong diagonal reflecting that. We also see these sort of fainter wings off the side of that. This reflects mixing in households between adults and children. And it's in households that the age generations combine. Now, if we were drawing this matrix for the influenza, and here the matrix is additionally coloured by susceptibility and infectiousness, we would see the darkest squares in this matrix in the age categories of 5 to 14. Children haven't been exposed to flu as much as adults. They're more susceptible. They're peak transmitters. They bring flu home to their parents, and their parents then take it to their friends. But for this virus, it's different. And we know this from looking all around the world over the past 18 months. Yes, children can get COVID, and we are concerned about them becoming infected and infectious, but they're nowhere near as good at it as their parents are. And so in this virus case, it's really the 20 to 39 years category who are the peak spreaders, and they will bring COVID home to their children, they will take it home to their own parents, and this is the group now where we're proposing a reorientation of the strategy. Next slide, please. We make that point by taking effects on transmission through to the next logical consequence. And this work involved a series of models of models. I said before, there are a lot of buckets along the far chain here as models of both infection transmission, epidemic dynamics, and then the consequences of those infections all feed into each other. And so the tables on the next three slides will refer to the clinical outcomes of these infections and break down where the infections are occurring, what age groups, and by vaccine status, you know, who is getting infected. And it's important to remember the vaccines we have are extremely good, but no vaccines are perfect. And as we increase population vaccine coverage, we expect to see more cases in people who are vaccinated, just because there are more of them. This is a very busy chart. So I'm going to take you through the key messages one by one. The main story of this chart is the comparison of that oldest first and all adult strategy. So are we looking for direct protection, or are we really maximising the impacts of a vaccine that we know now reduces transmission by targeting transmitters? So we're going to start with the 60 plus column, because this is an age group obviously of concern in terms of severe outcomes. And within, under the 60 years column, we have outcomes for vaccinated and unvaccinated individuals. And under all our strategies, under the allocation modelling that was undertaken, we get to something like 85 to 90% coverage in that critical age group. So direct protection remains critical. I'm then going to take you through first the darker shaded bars for the oldest first strategy. So we can see if we look at vaccinated versus unvaccinated, we have 2.5 times as many symptomatic infections in the vaccinated group. There are 9 times as many of them. If we then look at the consequences of those symptomatic infections, vaccines protect individuals against progression to severe outcomes. By the time we step through ward admissions, ICU admissions and deaths, we end up having fewer deaths off 2.5 times as many infections at the beginning. So this shows that the additional impacts of direct protection are critical, and the oldest first strategy still works well for vaccinated people. If we then compare those darker shaded bars with the lighter shaded bars, so we have essentially the same vaccine coverage in this 60 plus age group, by pursuing an all adults transmission reducing strategy, we halve all of these outcomes all the way down. So this is showing why, at this point, a strategic shift to targeting transmission and stopping these people getting exposed in the first place can substantially improve outcomes. And I'll just quickly reflect on the fact, if you look at the less than 16 years group, and in none of our modelling have we, or none of the models presented here, consider immunisation of school children, but by vaccinating parents, you protect children. And if you look again at the oldest first and the all-adult strategies, you can see that adverse health outcomes in children are dramatically reduced by this strategy as well. Next slide, please. So the next two slides I'm not going to speak to in as much detail, but I'll frame the key messages of them. This next slide, the addendum to the modelling, which is the second part of the technical report, basically took that key message that immunising younger people, reducing transmission is critical to maximising the gains of a whole population program, and worked again with the team in health to devise a strategy that was feasible and implementable. And this is a strategy that basically follows where we are right now, but brings forward immunisation of the 30 to 39 years group, to the beginning of September and 16 to 29 to early in October. And if we roll our program out that way, the key message of these slides, and I'll leave you to look at the detail later, but these darker, lighter rows now compare our hypothetical strategy with a feasible strategy that we call transmission reducing. And we see that across these various columns and down the rows, we achieve slightly better outcomes with that feasible strategy. So we were very pleased that something that was practical certainly captured the benefits of that earlier hypothetical proposal. And just on the next slide, the other thing to point out here, so this is coming back to this idea of synergies between interventions. So we've said in the earlier slides, all of these outcomes are if all you have is vaccination and some degree of contact tracing, but it's getting stressed because your case numbers are getting high. If we preserve the system by maintaining some low-level restrictions and supporting that public health response, if you look at the dark and light shaded bars all the way down this particular chart, you can see that we can achieve substantive reductions if we can maintain that capacity and maintain those community behaviours by 100-fold or more. So this is very strongly the case that supports a combined strategic approach for the shift to Phase B. Next slide, please. This final slide just summarises, and again, I'm sorry that some of the shading is out there, so I will read out some numbers for you. We are still understanding the Delta strain. We are still gathering evidence around the world about vaccine effectiveness against this strain and in a whole range of population settings that are quite different from ours, where different proportions of the population are vaccinated and different measures have been in place and case loads from the beginning are very different. But basically what we are delighted to see and what really supports the use of both of the vaccines that we have in Australia is that both the Pfizer and AstraZeneca doses are highly effective at reducing severe disease outcomes following two doses. And I'll read the numbers out for you because they're shaded. But basically for Pfizer, the reduction in hospitalisation is 87%, ICU admission 87% and mortality 92%. And for AstraZeneca, the corresponding numbers are 86, 86 and 90%. So we have two very highly effective vaccines and this work really encourages their best strategic use. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much,